Okay, we are live.
Hi.
And maybe talk a little bit just because so people can gather in.
Right, okay. Hi everyone, coming in. Hello, welcome to the first Friday at the EAM. We're so excited to have you here digitally here in Brooke Atherton's show, Mothers and Daughters. Wait just a little bit for people to gather, but I know everyone is excited to listen to Brooke talk about her work and this exciting new exhibit we've got going on. So I'll just go ahead and introduce Brooke. Hello, Brooke, over there.
Hello, Amanda. I'm happy to be here. Thank you so much for inviting me.
Of course, of course. So this exhibit, Mothers and Daughters, kind of tell me where that idea came from.
It's sort of a thank you to my mother. She's the one that sent me to art school. She went to work as a bridal consultant to pay for my education, and I didn't realize that at first. I was the oldest of five, and so that must have been very difficult for her to hold a household, the kids together, and work full time. And when I was out of school, I asked her what I could do to thank her. And she said, oh, honey, this is just what we do. And I found out later that she had wanted to study art in college herself, but as a Depression baby, she wasn't allowed to. She was told that her father would pay for her education if she became a teacher or a nurse. So she went, we were in Springfield, Ohio. She went down to Cincinnati to the School of Nursing, lasted about a week when one of her patients kept exposing himself intentionally to her. And she just thought, I can't deal with this. And she must not have liked it to start with. But she got on the bus, came home, got a job at the Massey Ferguson farm implement dealership where she sold tractors. So that she made it possible for me to study what I wanted, it slowly dawned on me what a gift that was. So she said at one point, you know, I'd really like a picture of a tree for the living room. And why don't you do a nice drawing or a painting to go over the couch? And that'll make me really happy. And, you know, my heart drops to my feet because I cannot draw. If you look around you here, there are no nice drawings of normal things. And I told her, I can't do that. I'm sorry. She thought it was me being difficult. But I tried, and I showed them to her, and she said, oh, you really can't draw, can you? Okay, we're even. And so that was that. But I became obsessed through the years. Every now and then, I would think, well, if I can't draw an actual tree, how do I capture the spirit of the tree? And, you know, the movement in the wind. And we go camping a lot with our kids. And I'll be sitting in my chair around the campfire watching the trees move. And it's still a mystery to me how to present that. And I keep trying. So you'll see different references to trees as we go. Now, this is my mother's wedding dress. She and Daddy were married in 1951, and Queen Elizabeth II was, I just watched The Crown last year on TV, and this is where this style came from, out of the blue, with the big train, and all my mother's girls, there are three of us, at an early age, it became apparent that none of us were ever going to wear this in a wedding. You know, we're all taller than she is. We've all got larger waists. So we were allowed to play with it. My sister wore the And I left as much intact as possible because I, as an artifact, I love the way this is put together. Speaking of artifacts, one of the things I did after college was volunteer, and occasionally when they had the budget, I was actually paid to play in the dirt by a Museum of Natural History. They were excavating and reconstructing a 12th century Native American village. This was in Dayton, Ohio, and it was just a fascinating experience for me. So this dress, I didn't know this until about 2 years ago when I threw this off of our deck. I was going to hose it down and kind of knock the dust back. I threw it over the railing on the deck and saw that it made an almost perfect circle. It took like 50 years for me to figure that out. Now, the village that we were reconstructing back in Dayton was also laid out in a circle. So as I started thinking about using this as an art object, the idea of circles within circles became very important. One of my jobs was to cut down saplings with a machete and peel the bark off of them, and they were used to as support posts for the Waddle and Daub houses that we reconstructed. Now, I'm not a trained archaeologist, so I wasn't allowed to do any digging. But what I did was head up work crews to build a fence, basic reconstruction. And so it just seemed like a natural to overlay the ideas of the archaeology of my life with the structure of what was going on at the village. Also at the Indian village, it was an interesting work crew because even though the head guys, there were, you know, the museum director and then the curator of archaeology and anthropology were both men, year after year it seemed like there were more women who were willing to volunteer, or we had an ethnobotanist, a biologist. Most of them were women, so it was real interesting getting a feminine perspective as we analyzed a lot of the information. Now also, being layered here are things from my childhood. Old photographs, the old hand-colored ones, portraits. This pretty much sums up the issues between my mother and me. I mean, we actually got along, you know, very well, but like any mother-daughter, there's a lot of pushing and pulling. This is a dress that, or a jacket, a little coat that she made for me, and it makes another nice circle that looks good there. She was an avid gardener, and I thought it appropriate to add some a layer of squares, small squares of fabric that has been dyed naturally with plants from the Billings area, or there are some other plants that were brought in just for fun. Also tea bags represent a nice social structure. She was fascinated by the American West. Now my father came from Oaxaca, Colorado, and my mother expected to move to Colorado when they got married, but Daddy wanted to stay in Ohio. So that's how I came to grow up there. What else is on there?
Talk about the concept of fire, because I know fire, you know, kind of played a big role in the village that you were reconstructing.
Yeah, fire is a process, burning things as a process is important in early cultures because that's how you fire a pot, you know, the obvious things. Also, it
cauterizes.
I forget the word.
Cauterize? I think you said that
structures, Waddle and Dog, with a grass roof. And somebody came down and set the house on fire. And it was a shock, but we were kind of whispering among ourselves. Everybody else in town was like, oh, I'm so sorry for that. And we're all like, no, that's okay. Because it hid all of our mistakes. And then with the next houses, we could correct those as we learned more. So I just thought that the two overlapping, you know, learning about your place, the place of a woman in a matriarchal, matrilineal society is different than American culture back in the 1950s. The mountains is the Western landscape that I use a lot. Sort of my view west from Ohio. We cross the plains so many times on family vacations that I would just stare at the horizon until I saw those mountains start to show up. There's broken slate.
I see a record in there.
Yeah, there's. I forget what the title of the song is, but it has something to do with children or, anyway.
Just going to say, for a lot of its life that I've seen this dress, it was a dress, it wasn't on the background. And I know the background edition was very recent, and the pose that you put her in was very recent. So kind of talk about, what was that like, and why did you decide on this pose?
When I first proposed this idea to the museum, I wanted that circle. It is just such a powerful image of the arms out and this wonderful circle. But then people, we all started responding to the dress sort of dancing and moving. And I was at a friend's house, and she has this gorgeous studio. I mean, hers is clean. Mine has fabric pieces all over the floor, so I can't use it to lay this out. So we put it there and just started moving the arms around and gave the dress this nice swish, like it's moving through time and space. And that's what I was going for here, but reality intervened. We, you know that hailstorm? Hailstorms play a part in this show also. The latest one, the workmen a year after the storm finally were able to get to us. And so all of a sudden I didn't have room to really lay this out. I would do it in sections. So when we brought it down here, I didn't have the sense of motion that I want. And this is how I work. When you work with large pieces, you work on it on the floor, on a table, horizontally, and then you hang it to see where you stand. The same thing happened with the mat over there with the quilt. You can see how it nicely draped. Mm-hmm. That's sort of what I was going for here. This is rather stiff now because it has layers of
things.
I do a lot of layering and pulling back and sanding, and I use glues, I use stabilizers. This will eventually get a lot more stitching on it. Mm-hmm. Normally, I had to give that up because I'm wearing my body down. My shoulder is wrapped at this point. Because I just couldn't. The heart on my sewing machine is this big. Mm-hmm. And to work all this fabric, roll it up, unroll it, shove it through, wad it up, It was just too much. Mm-hmm. So,
so do you think you're going to keep her in this pose in the future? You're going to move her around?
I want, that's not for fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I knew that when I was sewing her down. If you look at it.
She's very easily removable, if she needs to be.
And that goes into when I was growing up. We were allowed to play with this. This was a tent. This was all kinds of things. It was not a an object that hung in the closet for very long. It was, anyway, but it is a very special dress. I have rarely seen one that is this incredibly made.
Now, speaking of tents, do we want to talk about the tent? Because I think sort of when we first talked about the dress as a tent, that's where this idea of a tent sort of came from. So we want to go in here.
Okay.
We'll move around. This is free form. By the way, if you're on Facebook Live, if you have any questions, just let us know. I and Brooke are willing to answer anything. I shouldn't speak for you, Brooke. But I am willing to answer anything. So here's the tent. So let's talk about that.
Okay, the tent, another circle, or half circle, and then you add the doors, and that adds another probably fourth to the tent. We used to camp in when we were in Arizona. It's just perfect for two or four people, a few dogs, and of course you can't have a fire, we could have coals in there to stay warm, but you can see the holes in it.
Yeah.
We gave it some good use. My husband traded for that. Honey, I got all the tent. Oh, it's an interesting one.
Yeah.
And now, when we had originally talked about the tent on the wall, that's a different tent that we have, this white canvas. Much larger than this, and a whole different shape. It's a wall tent. But then COVID struck, and I started thinking about the idea of shelter, and you know, there was so much we didn't know last winter about that disease, and I think that's where a lot of the angst came from, and. So I started thinking of this as a refugium. If you have an aquarium, you know what that is. If you don't, it's a place of seclusion for any population of fish, of people, of plants. There are seeds that are held in case we lose certain plants, well, we have the seeds stored. So I started thinking of this as a refugium to protect myself, but I mean, I know that a piece of canvas is not going to save me from any virus, but still, it was just a pleasant thing to think about. And all of these landscapes around it is my vision of a pretty perfect walk in the woods. I use these landscapes a lot. This is also kind of a teaching thing too, because people started through the years, they give me things they don't know what else to do with. Like my great aunt made this, or my grandmother made these, and I'm moving so I can't keep them, and I know you'll do something with them. These are all variations on the log cabin block, and I thought that that fit nicely with the idea of shelter, a Western shelter. I like that there are different eras represented here. I started just cutting up handwork, and now pretty quickly, they started warning us that this disease is going to come back, at least for a couple more seasons. So intentionally, you can see that I've got more things. I started using that. It needles beautifully, so I like using, I'm going to use that here. These photos were taken by my husband when we first moved here with the original digital camera that they came out with and sold on eBay. Yeah. You can't adjust the focus, you can't adjust the exposure. It was just, talk about a stripped down point and shoot. So we took that out in the woods, and in one trip here, we saw a moose, we saw the sow and her cub, the owl, and of course sunrises, sunsets. And
I know this pattern here particularly, there's some question about what it is. And so Brooke is accepting all ideas about what this is. She thought maybe a deer, and now you said deer, I can't unsee deer.
But, I know. Yeah, I don't know which side is up. I don't know. I think it's Scandinavian, but I don't know that.
Yeah,
it was a yard sale find.
Yeah,
and I love it.
Yeah.
I think it's beautiful.
Yeah.
Perfect colors. The handwork is gorgeous. I really love it.
Yeah.
This is what my mother's dress.
Oh yeah, there it is.
Yeah.
The original plot.
When I made it. And you know, another weird thing that started happening is that I photographed my work to look at it now, instead of hanging it on the wall and shooting it, I just have this urge to lay it on the grass.
On the grass.
Surrounded by something green, healthy, growing.
Yeah.
So that's what that looks like.
Yeah.
All this stuff is going to be added to this. That's an antique quilt. My husband has a 76 bright orange Chevy step back pickup truck.
Mm-hmm.
That's like his oldest child.
Yeah.
And he decided that this summer he was going to redo the bed of the truck, which is gorgeous oak. And so he got some wood and sanded it and sealed it and took the bed off. And he put the whole thing back together. While he had it apart, I took all the rusty parts and laid them on two or three layers of silk organza, which you can see through beautifully. And it's kind of stiff, so it's easy to work with. And so the sun is made with the orange truck. I'm really happy about being able to include that there. And then one of my favorite quotes, I put it on the borders of all my work that is based on these landscapes, because it confronts how precious life is, how things change, how nothing stays the same. The hills are shadows and they flow from form to form, and nothing stands. Like clouds, they shape themselves and go. And I guess I like that because from all those years of driving back and forth across where the inland sea was, where dinosaurs roamed, where you get a sense of the vastness of this continent, of how things change.
Mm-hmm.
And we just have to accept that.
Yeah.
I guess
these are a nice transition, talking about your COVID time, especially COVID calendar here.
Yeah, the COVID calendar is the one in the center. These are all measuring devices, and the red one came first.
Just get in the shot.
Get in the shot!
Yes.
This one, okay, give you a sense of how tall this is. The title of this is 20 feet deep. The piece is actually, I think, 21 and a half feet long, but when Hurricane Katrina hit, we had been camping. So we came back to town, and headlines are all, you know, if you've ever wanted to see a disappointed newscaster, that was the time. There was so much sadness. And one guy, the morning after it hit, he said, well, there's no story here. Hmm. He actually said that. and I thought, okay, we can go camping again. Mm-hmm. So we went back out, and when we came back, we found out about the storm surge that caused all the devastation. And what I kept reading through a couple weeks' worth of newspapers that had been held for us were water, was about water that was 20 feet deep in places. And I heard that over and over, and I was cleaning house one day. And I'm thinking, okay, what does that look like? What does that feel like, 20 feet of water? So I started measuring things. I started with my dog, and then I measured myself, and then, I don't know, the ceiling in the dining room, and then the ceiling in the vaulted part of the living room, and then I moved outside and measured, we have a second floor deck, and so I measured that to the ground. And by then my husband was home from golfing, and he was getting into it. He got out the extension ladder and duct taped his long tape measure to the apex of the roof of our house, and we measured that to the ground, and we still weren't at 20 feet. Mm-hmm. And of course, at that point, you begin to really, you know, it hits home what these people had to deal with. Now, at the same time, I had two friends who were dying of cancer, one in Ohio and the other one here in Billings. And I found myself one day feeling very jealous and left out because here were two women who had never met each other in person, but were writing back and forth, talking about their medications and their treatment schedules, and leaving me totally out of it. Mm-hmm. And I was jealous of this new friendship, and I'm going, wait, think what you're asking here. So as they progressed, I started doing things like burning, Why Have You Forsaken Us, this is a plastic fabric, so it holds the shape of the letters. I take my dogs for walks and find, you know, I pick up weird little things, and that's how this started, adding stuff, and more stuff, and knots, and then, communication. I found a broken radio part up at behind Skyview School. Excuse me. So that was in reference to the reporters and just how disappointed I was in them that they actually were disappointed that there were dead bodies, floaters. Mm-hmm. And then by the time I got to the top of this, it was just layers of black fabric, black stitches, and my fingers were bleeding from the backs of the needles as I pushed them through, because I didn't use a thimble very often. Mm-hmm. So it was a very physical exercise for me. And now, this one and the one with the yellow dress on it, this is a good exercise for an artist who wants to exhibit in museums, and that is to trust the curators.
Spread that word around, everyone.
Really, you guys are so full of ideas, and you're all artists yourselves, you know, I came to find out. Now, this is a technical aspect, but I had started showing this on pedestals, white painted pedestals of diminishing size, three or four of them, and I thought that looked fine. And then I had a one-person show in a museum in Huntington, West Virginia. A guy named John Farley was in charge of handing the show, and I'm going to give a shout out to him because he's the one that came up with using the dowels, and it just made this really special. Mm-hmm. And also, they had a highly polished wood floor there, and he's the one that put the bottom of the pieces against that so that it reflected the whole length of the gallery.
Yeah.
And he took me in through that door, so he was definitely
very proud
of
that's cool.
That. And it was just a great display. The one with the yellow dress is about recovery, and that's the one that has to do with the hailstorm. You know, just when you think you're recovering from one disaster, another one hits. And, oh, here, these little pieces of pottery, redware. I brought that from Ohio with me, and State Farm insisted on paying me for the, you know, full price for that. So we wanted to make you feel whole.
Oh.
And I'm like, okay.
All right.
That's the redware pot. And those, yeah. that white piece of ash is sitting in the hail went zoom. The wind was blowing that hard. I was impressed. So I saved the clock.
Well, yeah. And it's perfect for this. Like you designed it for that.
I love that. So this is the third of the measuring devices. This went together really quickly because I already made two others and I knew the logistics of it. I used a vintage cotton woven, you know, towel, you know, the old style crank and pull it. I found it at an estate sale around here, and just some other fabrics that I had. And I wanted the top to be darker than the front or the bottom to refer to how scary it was dealing with a disease that we had no idea what the parameters were, how long it was going to last, and how to deal with it. And every time anybody talked about it, it seemed like it was just getting worse and worse. Okay, these are just, I had a bunch of paper stuff left that I've been lugging around for years. Mm-hmm. I had this musical score. I've heard somebody play this, actually. I can't play.
And I love it's Nostradamus. It's very appropriate given the time period.
Yeah. And this is my mother and me. And see, we got along great. We got along fine.
You look like you have a great relationship.
Looking for angst,
yeah.
You know? I think one of the problems is that I was called Little Margie when I was growing up. Everyone in town.
And that was your mom's name?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. So, oh, you look exactly like your mom. Mm-hmm. And she was such a nice, well-respected person. That's a lot to live up to. So I just rebelled. By the time I was in college, I had a sculpture instructor who shook his head and he said, you know, if you and your mother ever make up, it's going to ruin your art career. It's
going to
ruin your art.
That's funny.
And then my sister-in-law put it in perspective when we would have these battles. Mm-hmm. She said, you know, people who have crazy mothers like I do, and her mother is certifiable, she said, we would kill to have a mother like yours.
Mm, yeah.
So I just thought, yeah, that's unique. I need to give her more respect. one thing I did last winter, spring.
What is this
kind
year?
Of wind.
Yeah, exactly.
I set for myself a task of making. You know, I was talking about the log cabin blocks over there. I wanted to make two log cabin blocks every night, hand stitched, mm-hmm. out of tea bags. Mm-hmm. And so I got pretty bored with the traditional ones. They're very simple. My dad he studied architecture. Mm-hmm. So he used to drag me around work sites, and I'd get to play with all the trash piles and see how all the buildings went together. And so I started making some free-form log cabins and then different architectural, Frank Lloyd Wright house. We had a Frank Lloyd Wright house in Springfield. And mm-hmm. So each of these has a different historical reference. And you can see the one that has the blue, the pale blue, that's silk. I started adding other fabrics. And this is India ink that I just brushed over it, stitched down. This is my reference to how important it is to vote. It's probably illegal for me to have those ballots.
That's what's holding up the election.
Do they count?
But, so if you guys get raided, that's what they're about.
Oh, great, thanks.
And then, I started realizing that I finally had time, since when we were locked in, to do things I thought I just threw in a pile and said, I'll deal with this later, I want to read this later. Okay, for instance, Polly Applebaum, when she was here, I had one of the catalogs from her show. Mm-hmm. So I went back and I went online and I got to study her work a little more. Mm-hmm. And it was just the right, the circle, mm-hmm. The right hint of yellow. And so there are references to my history with Yam here too. There's the book about the vault and my stay there. All these little holes are sitting outside playing with the dog and playing with my soldering iron, and just because I'm sick of being in the house. This is why I can't sew anymore, because I use heavy, heavy tent canvas. I use cardboard. I use plastic from soda bottles. Now, this is an example of what happens when you run a plastic bottle through a printer, and that printer had to be thrown away.
I hope you didn't
need that. Insect-like thing.
Sure.
It's like, what's the worst that can happen?
Yeah.
That's my favorite question.
Why don't you just buy a new printer? It's fine.
Yeah, you're going to need one anyway.
Yeah.
Okay, these are some early landscapes. And I was cutting up a book of fairy tales, years and days passed away. I just like the reference to when I was talking about crossing the Kansas, Oklahoma, flat, hot areas of the country. What else? I guess.
And the fact that it's ending in the basket, I feel like that's an important part of it too.
Well, because I want to keep working on this. Mm-hmm. We know it's coming back. Mm-hmm. So
it's not over yet.
Yep.
I hope this piece is shorter than I think it's gonna be.
Okay, so these are one set of long skinny pieces, and I have no idea. Well, it's a timeline. Some people want to call them scrolls. I don't really care what you want to call them. Now, those over there are definitely trees, though.
Yes, these are trees.
These are just different trees that I picked up while we've been camping. I don't know why I'm fascinated by those. We didn't have them in Ohio. We had trees that, where I camped there, they weren't these nice weathered out things. I kind of relate them. There were five of us children, and I relate them to us kids. Mm. I will think I have a piece finished, and then 5 years later, I'll realize that, oh, no,
there's more to do.
Yeah, like, these are done. Mm-hmm. These are done. I can tell you that. It's just a feeling I get. The dress is not done. Mm-hmm. So, I pull things back all the time, mm-hmm. and give it another layer. Now, in talking about, there's a whole area of textile buy, you know, from the sale table, the stuff at half price. And no, it's a fascinating process of adding color, taking color away. The black and white, that's black fabric that discharges to white. And now that alone is unusual. Usually there's a base color that shows up. This was a bleach discharge process using snow and ice. And what you do is put the black fabric down, you know, mooshed up, and then you shovel snow on it. We did this down at the vault, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
And then you smoosh the ice or snow around. The snow gives you a finer look, but ice you can do any time of the year. And then you kind of pour bleach over that, walk away, come back and check it, because it is fascinating to watch. And as this water melts, the fabric gets wet and it pulls the either the dye or the bleach into it.
I'm going to get a little zoom up so they can see this on Facebook.
And there's another step here that is my personal secret. And I'm not turning loose of it yet, because I've had very experienced surface designers say this is driving me nuts.
Oh, watch out for the log. Piece of wood.
Yeah, these will eventually have things in them. Petrified wood from Arizona, where we have, that's part of a different story. Mm-hmm. What else?
I see more of the log cabin tea bags
in
here.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's the most recent one. The rest of these go back to, I was working on them in the mold. Like this one, all this melted aluminum, that's Brian Scott's.
Yes.
He didn't clean up after himself, and he apologized for that. I go, no, I love it. Because now I get to use it. I use slate a lot, this I find where in the area that we can. These are not stitched down. I like the idea of them. I don't know, there's a ghostliness to these dead trees. We camped in the Little Belt Mountains in roughly the same area. So over the last 20, 22 years, I know my trees there. I watch them come and go.
And I know you told me the importance of the materials that are holding the trees up, too, that they're man-made and natural, that you wanted a variety of things propping the trees up.
Yeah, I still am, you know, partly it's just functional, that the bowl-shaped things, my husband was drilling that out, making something for me, and I kind of like it there, so that's where it is. I want to add something, a vertical something to that eventually. The red brick came, I brought all the way from Ohio with me. I actually paid movers to
move your brick?
To bring my brick.
That's a good brick. That's a nice brick.
Yeah. And then my sister-in-law in Arizona lives down by Winslow, and they have petrified wood logs on their land. And they sell it to places like the Smithsonian. I mean, logs are hard to come by. And so these are from Arizona.
So let's head up the hallway. We're about ready to wrap up, I think. But I just kind of want to talk about your grief maps, the silk panels real quick, because I know those are pretty interesting as well. And they've never been displayed before like this, so I think it's important to talk about that. So kind of talk about the process of these here.
So these also are related to Brian Scott's work. When I moved into the bowl, there was a very heavy, it was about this size, piece of thick metal that he had made after his sister died. And that's what ties it into the grieving process. And I just thought that it was a very powerful piece, physically and mentally. thankfully. Mm-hmm. And I thought, what can I ever do with fabric that would convey that? And so I started using dyes. I pulled out some like bronze and iron dyes and just started silk screening them. The next step is to add some hand stitching. Mm-hmm.
So these are not done either.
These are not scars. And then rust on top of it.
Yeah, the detail on this is,
you know,
beautiful.
The sun and a breeze coming through silk is just wonderful. Can we talk about...
Yeah, let's talk about this piece.
This is an early piece. This is called The Shirt Off My Back, On My Back.
Shirt On My Back.
Okay, and this has to do with the fire in the Emerald Hills area that happened soon after we moved here. And a friend of mine lived there, and she let us all know, she'd just come from a meeting that we'd all been at, and she let us all know that she was able to get out with her grandson just with the shirts on their back. She had a laptop because she hadn't brought that out of the car from our meeting. And so we're in the Little Belt Mountains up on a hill, and there's a fire crew down in the meadow down in the valley where we usually camp. And they had been working on a forest fire there. And so I asked them if they minded if we had a campfire. And they said, oh, no, that's fine. Just, you know, don't let it get out of hand, please. And so I watched them, and I just started wondering what the whole thing about with the shirt on my back is, because you hear that all the time. So I took my t-shirt off, and that's this one. And there are Japanese techniques known as shibori, where you fold the fabric, you tie it. It's like a tie-dye, only better. And so that's what I did. I took one of those sticks, one of those trees, and ripped my t-shirt into strips and laid them down the length and then tied it with string and scrunched them up as I went real tightly and held it over a fire like a hot dog. And this became one of my signature techniques, because again, nobody can figure out how I did that. But you can see where it actually burned. So that's what it looks like with t-shirt fabric. This is what it looks like with a lighter weight cotton weave. And then this has a layer of silk organza that's been rusted. I also rust things frequently. A lot of found objects from walks, and you find different artifacts in the mountains than you do in the heights.
Well, is there anything you kind of want to add, Brooke, before we wrap up tonight?
No, I think
we've got covered.
Yeah, covered different variations.
Yeah, I thought it was great. We really tied everything back to your mom, and I think that was the important thing. You know, this is really a tribute to her.
I just want to make it clear that I love my mother.
Yeah.
And I wish she could have been here. She would have had so much fun.
Yeah. Absolutely. Well, thank you, Brooke, and thank you for your amazing work, and thank you for letting us have this amazing show of yours.
Thank you.
Facebook, for watching. Do we have any questions? I wasn't really looking.
We don't have any questions. We just have people that are excited to come in and see this in person. People are excited to come and see this show. Come in person and see it. Yeah.
This is one of those things, you know, like, this doesn't need to be on here, but...
Oh, we're still live. We got it.
We're still live.
Bonus content.
In 1 minute, you're the oldest child, and then 5 minutes later, you find out you have an older sister. Mm-hmm. That's what this is. My grandmother, while my mother was in the hospital having a baby, my grandmother spilled the beans, and I found out I had an older sister who died in the hospital when she was 3 days old, and my mother... This is when they didn't have private rooms. She was in a ward with mothers who were nurses would fathers, and my mother had to live through that for 3 days. And the past time she read The Tale of Two Cities, and people said, why did she choose that? I have no idea. I have a copy of the book, I've never been able to read it. But that's what this is about. I'll fill in my...
And then these are pieces of model airplane, correct?
Yes. Mm-hmm. I've got the rest of it.
Okay. So. If you need a companion piece.
Yeah. But it's one of those weird things where family histories, just you never know what's going to pop up. Mm-hmm. And as the oldest, I've heard stories that my brothers and sisters are not privy to. Mm-hmm. And I asked them about it, and they said, oh, you're making that up. Mm-hmm. No?
Yeah.
I wish I was.
Yeah.
And I think that's very normal.
Oh, yeah.
It's like people want to be remembered. They want the truth to be out there, but mm-hmm. not too much.
Right.
So.
Right.
So anyway.
I think that's a good point to end on, you know? It's just that idea of families, you know? They are what they are. Sometimes they're good, sometimes they're bad.
This is that molybdenum mm-hmm. that relates to those other pieces. That's what this is stained with. Mm-hmm. The orange, red, and then the fugitive blue. Mm-hmm. It stays blue for a while, but then as it oxidizes, it disappears. So it's not a stable color. Mm-hmm. But anyway, more surface design stuff.
Well, thank you so much, Brooke. I really appreciate you. We'll wrap up again. No, you're good.
You know, it has been so much fun working with you. Aww. You're really good at this.
Oh, thank you.
And I have to say, you guys did a great job of hanging it.
Oh, thanks. I appreciate that.
You know, I wouldn't change anything.
Oh, good. I'm glad.
All right.
Well, thank you, Facebook viewers. Please come see the show. It is up until... January.
Mid, like the 10th or 11th.
Yeah, something
mid
like
January.
That. I'm not good with dates and COVID makes things weird.
Yeah.
But yes, come in. It's up, it's here, it's beautiful. And then Tracy Linder's show is coming up soon too. So you'll be able to see them together, which is super exciting. So absolutely come in soon. So thank you, Facebook. Have a good evening and have a good weekend.